This morning, we're going to be teaching and preaching out of the book of Nehemiah. That's where our text is going to come from. It's going to encompass both chapter 1 of Nehemiah and also chapter 8. And a whole lot of history, I'm sure, in between. And so that's what we'll do, at least with the first chapter, is we will begin to read. And if the Lord should say so, maybe give a little commentary as we read. Chapter 1 of the book of Nehemiah, right after Ezra, which is right after 2 Chronicles. By the way, we started a series on Wednesday and Sunday nights where we're actually preaching each book of the Bible and moving through, and we should get to 2 Kings tonight. But I got to tell you that when we get past 2 Chronicles, you would think next is going to be the book of Ezra, but we're going to actually do it in the proper chronological order. So Ezra and Nehemiah is going to come towards the end of the Old Testament. We'll explain that when we get there. I may explain a little bit of it this morning, but let's start reading in verse 1 of Nehemiah chapter 1. The words of Nehemiah, the son of Hakaliah, and it came to pass in the month Chislu, in the 20th year, as I was in Shushan, the palace, that Hanani, one of my brethren, came. He and certain men of Judah, and I asked them concerning the Jews that had escaped, which were left of the captivity, and concerning Jerusalem. And they said unto me, the remnant that are left of the captivity there in the province are in great affliction and reproach. The wall of Jerusalem also is broken down, and the gates thereof are burned with fire. And it came to pass, when I heard these words, that I sat down and wept and mourned certain days and fasted and prayed before the God of heaven and said, I beseech thee, O Lord, God of heaven, the great and terrible God that keepeth covenant and mercy for them that love him and observe his commandments. Let thine ear now be attentive and thine eyes open, that thou mayest hear the prayer of thy servant, which I pray before thee now, day and night. For the children of Israel, thy servants, and confess the sins of the children of Israel, which we have sinned against thee. Both I and my father's house have sinned. We have dealt very corruptly against thee, and have not kept the commandments, nor the statutes, nor the judgments, which thou commandest thy servant Moses. Remember, I beseech thee, the word that thou commandest thy servant Moses, saying, if ye transgress, I will scatter you abroad among the nations. But if ye turn unto me and keep my commandments and do them, though there were of you cast out into the uttermost part of the heaven, yet will I gather them from thence, and I will bring them unto the palace that I have chosen, that I have chosen to set my name there. Let's read a little bit of chapter 2. And it came to pass in the month Nisan, in the 20th year of Artaxerxes, the king, that wine was before him, and I took up the wine and gave it unto the king. Now I had not been before time sad in his presence. Wherefore the king said unto me, why is thy countenance sad, seeing thou art not sick? This is nothing else but sorrow of heart. Then I was very sore afraid, and said unto the king, let the king live forever. Why should not my countenance be sad when the city, the place of my father's sepulchres, another word for tombs, lieth waste, and the gates thereof are consumed with fire? Real quick before we move to chapter 8, I just want to talk to you a little bit about what's going on here. What we see in this passage of scripture is that Nehemiah, he's sad, he's weeping, he's got a great job, really. He's a cupbearer in the king of Persia's palace. That means that he's a very trusted servant. Now you have to understand that Nehemiah is a Jewish man, and that Israel finds themselves in a precarious situation because of the sins of their past. We're about to talk about that in a moment. But what I need you to know is that Nehemiah has actually found himself in a rather good position, if a good position could be found, when the children of God as a whole find themselves in the midst of captivity. In other words, as an individual person, he's not doing that bad. He's got a really good job. He stays in the king's presence in Persia. He lives in the palace. He's got a very important job. He has to taste the wine before it's given to the king to make sure that it's not poisoned. You know, that's how they used to get rid of kings back in the day. They'd give poison. Shakespeare wrote a whole play on it, whenever they poured the poison in his ear and all this other kind of stuff like that. That was the way that they took out these kings. And so he's very trusted. But he gets correspondence from people that know what's going on the outside. What's going back in Jerusalem? And what he hears is that the people that are there are under great affliction. There's chaos. There's turmoil. There's great agony that's taking place in those people's lives. The city itself, the walls are broken down. The gates are burned. And when he hears the report of what is told to him, he begins to weep. He begins to weep and his countenance becomes very sad. And ultimately, when he brings that countenance into the presence of the king of Persia, the king is going to give him an edict or a decree, the ability to go back to Jerusalem and to rebuild that wall. I need you to understand something this morning, that God has a plan, amen? It's a big eternal plan. And he utilizes people like Nehemiah, he utilizes people like Elijah, he utilizes people like Peter, and he uses people like you, Christian, as part of this eternal plan that he's moving humanity through. Many times we can get so caught up in our own personal circumstances that we forget that God has a big plan called salvation history, and he wants to use you and he wants to use me as vessels in the midst of that plan. Now, as far as Israel goes in this time frame, we're going to just kind of fast forward a little bit. We're not going to talk about the fall. I usually draw like a little chronology timeline to try to make sure we're all on the same page. We're not going to go as far back as the fall. After the fall, though, God did call a man named Abraham, right? And he promised that he would make a great nation through him. There was no nation called Israel before. In case you haven't really read the Bible, I'm just going to give you a quick synopsis, amen? So that we can all be on the same page. So that we can all learn together. So there was a man named Abraham. His daddy was a maker of idols. He was a pagan. What's a pagan? A person that's not Jewish, that doesn't know the real God. A person who worships false gods. Before there was a nation called Israel, there were isolated men that knew how to worship God. But God called Abraham out of his father's house and he promised that he'd make him a great nation. Abraham began to have offspring, and his grandson, Jacob, had 12 sons. Jacob's name was changed to Israel on the night that he wrestled with the Lord and God touched him in his hip. Bible says that Jacob limped for the rest of his life. Sometimes God has to touch us in our hip and cause us to limp, and then he wants to change our name. He wants to teach us, amen. Sometimes we've got to be broken in the presence of God in order for him to really be able to speak to our heart and to reveal his truth unto us. Amen? And so anyway, Jacob's name was changed to Israel, and he had 12 sons, and his 12 sons became the 12 tribes of Israel. Now, as you know, that the 12 tribes of Israel became slaves in Egypt. For over 400 years there, they sat in an Egyptian in a foreign land, really symbolic of the world system. Many times God's people, like Israel was, find themselves in captivity to the world system. Pharaoh represents the enemy of our soul. I know you that come to church here are getting tired of hearing this, but you shouldn't get tired, because one day you're going to be able to preach it to the person, or teach it to the person that you're working with. Amen. That the world, like, and if they don't understand it, it's okay. Keep telling them that the world system is like Egypt. And sometimes God's own people, called by his name, can find themselves captive again in the midst of the world system under the leadership of a cruel taskmaster named Pharaoh, or otherwise known as Satan. But God has a plan of deliverance, hallelujah, and it's called the Exodus. I'm going to exit you out of the world, and it's going to come through the blood of the Lamb on the Passover night. The blood stricken on the doorpost and the side post. Judgment's coming to the land. But when you have the blood stricken on the doorpost, put it on your heart, Christian. What are you saying, preacher? I'm saying before you leave here this morning, whether you run to the altar like some have been known to do in the past, or you just sit in your chair, invite Jesus, the darling of heaven, into your heart and say, yes, Lord, I want to go your way. You shed your blood to pay the penalty of my sin. You took the judgment of sinful man upon you. Now I'm asking you, O Lord God, to put the blood blood on my heart and to come to live on the inside of me and exit me out of this world system. Exit me out of this Egyptian bondage, O Lord God, that I might walk in freedom so that I might serve you. And so that's where we're going to start. We're going to start with the Exodus. Now we have a people that are called by God and they've been exited out of Egypt. And then they began to wander. They wandered in a wilderness for 40 years. And we're not going to get into all that. Boy, there's a lot that can be preached on wandering in a wilderness. You may find yourself in a wilderness. You may not understand why you are where you are and why you're so frustrated in the place that you are. But listen to me. God knows how to use a wilderness experience. He actually, I will say this about it. In Deuteronomy chapter 8, God said this. I led you in the wilderness for 40 years.
Amen.
You see, I led you in the wilderness for 40 years to show you what was in your heart, to prove to you. I put you to the test. My own children called by my name. I led you in a wilderness experience for 40 years to reveal to you what was in you. And so when you find yourself in the midst of a wilderness, come on.
Amen.
The preacher's preaching to himself. When you find yourself in the midst of a wilderness, the Lord has a plan. He wants to put you to the test, and he wants to reveal to you what's really on the inside of your heart. There's nothing like a wilderness experience to begin to cause you to look introspectively at who you are on the inside and to say, oh, Lord, do something in me. Amen. Begin to change me. I didn't even know that was in there. That's what the wilderness does. And so they wandered in a wilderness, but under the leadership of Joshua, they finally made it into the promised land. And then there was a time frame known as the judges. At the end of the time frame known as the judges, the people of Israel cried out, give us a king. Make us like all the other nations. I got to tell you that if you cry loud enough and you allow your flesh to... See, Saul is what they got, and Saul's a type of the flesh. David's a type of the spirit because he's a type of Christ. And so if your flesh wants something bad enough and you demand it, give us a king. We want to be like the other nations. Give me what I want, God. I want to be like everybody else in the world. Give me the husband that I want, God. Give me the wife that I want, God. Give me whatever it is that I want, God. Not really taking into account God's plan and will for your own lives. Thinking that you have your own business figured out. And the reality of it is that you end up yoking yourself with flesh instead of spirit. And the next thing you know, you got a big old mess on your hands just like Israel did when they embraced Saul. But I want you to know that the time frame when Saul began was known as the time frame of the kings. We've been teaching on the kings. And what happens in the kings is this, is that after the fall of Solomon, a tragic thing takes place in the nation of Israel. King after king after king after king begin to worship false gods. Beginning with Elijah the Tishbite in 1 Kings 17, he's introduced on the scene. God begins to proclaim his word to a lost and a dying people that are supposed to be serving him. And Elijah the Tishbite begins to prophesy against King Ahab and Jezebel. Begins to tell the people that you need to choose this day whom you're going to serve. And God continues from that time moving forward to send the prophetic voice, the mouth of the prophet, to speak forth the truth of God's word. Most times God's prophet speaks forth the word of correction. Much of the modern church has been focused on the fact that he foretells the future, but the reality of it is, as much of the office of the prophet is more about forthtelling, telling the truth in a forthright manner, rather than foretelling. But what he would say is this, any prophet of God in that time frame, if you don't renounce your ways and turn your heart back towards me, you're going to find yourself in the midst of captivity. And where we are in the book of Nehemiah is the result of the time frame of the kings, whenever ultimately that really happened. A northern kingdom called Babylon came and took over and conquered that whole known world. Israel is over here, right? the Sea of Galilee, the Jordan River, the Dead Sea. This is Mount Carmel right here in this little chit by the Mediterranean Sea. This is Babylon. This is Persia down here. The king of Babylon begins to conquer all this area, but then the king rises up from Persia And he begins to conquer too. This is where we are in the time frame. This is approximately 400 years of God during the time frame of the kings prophesying to his children, turn back to me. Give your heart back to me. But because they would not do it, finally Babylon came in and brought them under bondage. But even then, other nations began to rise up. We won't go through the whole process because where we are in our story is that now, after Babylon rose up, there was a king from Persia. Daniel prophesied about it the night that it happened. A king from Persia began to rise up. Now the Persian Empire, which is now modern-day Iran, was in control of the whole thing. Israel found themselves as captives again. First time in Egypt, now they find themselves under Persian rule. Some of the people are back in Jerusalem. They're back in Jerusalem in a city where the walls have been broken down. Nehemiah gets word back on what's going on, and he begins to weep. He begins to weep, and you'll see in the midst of his prayer when he goes to the Lord that he knows why the people are in the condition that they are. And even though he is in a good position and he has a really good job working for the king of Persia, his heart is broken for the children of God. And he begins to cry out to the Lord. He says that we've sinned against you, God. Me and my father's house have sinned against you, Lord. And we've transgressed the covenant and the commandments that you gave unto Moses. But then he says in verse 8, he says, remember, I beseech thee. Oh God, won't you remember? I'm begging of you that you would remember the promises that you gave. What you said was, is that if we transgressed your covenants, you would scatter us abroad. But then you also said, but if you turn unto me and keep my commandments and do them, though there were of you cast out in the uttermost part of the heaven, yet will I gather them from there. And so Nehemiah begins to cry upon the Lord, and he actually, not as though God forgot, but he reminds God of his word. I got to tell you, sometimes, Christian, you may find yourself in the midst of a circumstance where you feel as though you've become captive again to your enemy. And listen to me, if you don't know the word of God, you don't have anything to draw back upon. Amen. I will say this, that the name of Jesus is powerful enough that if you become broken enough in your spirit, if you just cry upon the name of Jesus, hallelujah, it will begin a process where victory will begin to take place in the atmosphere. But listen to me today, Christian, if you haven't done your due diligence to study this book and to learn of the God that you serve, I want to encourage you to make sure that you open it up and that you begin to learn it. Nehemiah knew the word of God. Nehemiah knew the Old Testament law, and he began to cry out to God and say, oh, you who I ask of you to remember the word that you spoke, and that even though your people would be scattered, that you would return them again if we would turn. And Lord, as a representative of your people, I cry out to you and I ask that you would begin that process. Amen. Amen. So he shows up in the king's presence with this countenance that's saddened and downcast. And the king ultimately gives him this decree to go back and to build the wall. You can go back and build the wall. So he travels from this area, more than likely the province of Shushan. He's probably been deported down here to Persia. And now he has to travel back over here to Jerusalem, which was southern Israel. And when he gets there, he sees what he was told. The walls are broken down. The gates are burned. The city is in the midst of a big old mess. Now, you know, just for one second before we go to chapter 8, you can turn there. I would like to say this. I know that about 4 weeks ago or so, I was preaching and the Lord just dropped into my spirit about Jerusalem. And how Jerusalem is a type of you and I. And what I mean by that is this. The name Jerusalem itself literally means the city of peace. Jerusalem. Shalom. Peace. That's what the word shalom means in Hebrew. Peace. That's what the word, the city means. It's the city of peace. Now, those of us that have been studying the Bible for some time, and those of you who are new students to it, just sit back and let's enjoy a little bit of a lesson. That the reason why the city was known as peace, at least at that point in time, was because David, King David, had brought the presence of God to the home to rest in the city of Jerusalem. You see, there was a temple there that housed the presence of God. And behind the veil was the Ark of the Covenant with two cherubim that allowed the presence of God. He said, build me a sanctuary where my presence can dwell with my people. I will meet with you between the cherubim, two angels that sat upon the mercy seat. And the reason that God could dwell there was because there was an altar. There was an altar outside of the sanctuary, an altar outside of the temple. It was called a brazen altar. It was a type of the cross. And it was the place where the animal's neck was cut, his blood was collected, and that blood was taken behind the veil one time a year on the Day of Atonement, and blood was sprinkled upon the mercy seat, changing it from a place of judgment to a place of mercy. God's presence could dwell with Israel because of the blood of a blemishless lamb, which was a type that foreshadowed the day that his plan would be fulfilled when the darling of heaven, the eternal word that spoke the worlds into existence, would clothe himself with a tent of human flesh, and he would offer up his humanity that was without stain, without sin, upon the cross, and take your judgment, my judgment, upon him, and be the bearer of the sins of Adam's fallen race, and through that, hallelujah, he would restore the presence of God. And as the presence of God dwelt in Jerusalem, behind the veil, upon the mercy seat, so you, when you strike the doorpost of your heart with the blood of the eternal, fulfilling, blemishless lamb, the presence of God comes to live on the inside of you. Your human heart becomes the home of the Holy Spirit, hallelujah, and you, like a city that's walled off, become a protector and a housing place for the presence of God, and you, like a bunch of little Jerusalems walking around upon the face of a fallen earth, harboring within you the glory of the eternal God, hallelujah. Jesus said, Father, I glorified you, and Lord, and now Father, I'm glorified in them. In other words, the presence of Jesus lives in you, and the glory emanates out of you when you begin to learn how to walk in the Spirit and yield your life for the purposes of God. God will emanate from you, and he will use you to reveal the plan of God to a lost and a dying world. But the walls are broken down. The walls are broken down and the gates are burned. The temple has been ransacked and the altar has been desecrated. There is no sacrifice taking place. And the people that are there in captivity, and Nehemiah receives the word to go back and to build the wall. Let's read chapter 8 real quick. It says, and all the people gathered themselves together as one man into the street that was before the water gate. And they spoke unto Ezra the scribe to bring the book of the law of Moses, which the Lord had commanded to Israel. And Ezra the priest brought the law before the congregation, both of men and women, and all that could hear with understanding, upon the first day of the seventh month. I want you to take notice of that. The first day of the seventh month, okay? We'll come back to that. And he read therein before the street that was before the water gate, from the morning until midday, before the men and the women and those that could understand. And the ears of all the people were attentive unto the book of the law. And Ezra the scribe stood upon a pulpit of wood, which they had made for the purpose. And beside him stood Mattathiah and Shema and Ananiah and Urijah and Hilkiah and the Messiah on the right hand, and on his left hand, Padiah and Mishael and Malchiah and Hashem and Hashbadana and Zechariah and Meshulam. And Ezra opened the book in the sight of all people, for he was above all the people. And when he opened it, all the people stood up. And Ezra blessed the Lord, the great God, and all the people answered, Amen, Amen. With lifting up their hands, and they bowed their heads and worshiped the Lord with their faces to the ground. And Jeshua and Bani and Shabiah and Jamin, Akub, Shabbathiah, Hodijah, Messiah, Kelita, Azariah, Jozabad, Hanan, Peliah, and the Levites caused the people to understand the law, and the people stood in their place. So do you see what's going on here? They built a pulpit of wood. It wasn't like this one, but it was like a box. And Ezra stood up on it, and he opened up the Bible, the Old Testament. They hadn't been reading the Old Testament. They hadn't been reading the Old Testament law. And Ezra stood up on this box of wood, and he began to read the Word of God from the morning until midday. And I would imagine that the way that it happened, all these people we just listed off, plus the Levites, began to expound upon the Word of God. I don't know if he read the whole thing and then they expounded, or if as he was reading, there were places where the people didn't understand. Hold on right there, Ezra. Let's take a little time and let's explain the Word of God to the people. But they were out there for 4 to 5 hours focusing upon the Word of God. Amen. It says, so they read in the book of the law of God distinctly. That means that they gave understanding of it and gave the sense and caused them to understand the reading. And Nehemiah, which is the Tershatha, and Ezra, the priest, which is another word for governor, Tershatha, and Ezra, the priest, the scribe, and the Levites that taught the people, said unto all the people, this day is holy unto the Lord your God. This day is holy. Remember I told you, remember it's the first day of the seventh month? And now I just want you to see that this day is holy. We're going to get into that in a second. This day is holy unto the Lord your God. Mourn not, nor weep, for all the people wept when they heard the words of the law. Then he said unto them, go your way, eat the fat, and drink the sweet, and send portions unto them for whom nothing is prepared, for this day is holy unto our Lord. Neither be ye sorry, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. So the Levites stilled all the people, saying, hold your peace, for the day is holy, neither be ye grieved. And all the people went their way to eat and to drink and to send portions and to make great mirth, that's happiness and joyfulness, because they had understood the words that were declared unto them. And on the second day were gathered together the chief of the fathers of all the people, the priests and the Levites, unto Ezra the scribe, even to understand the words of the law. And they found written in the law, which the Lord had commanded by Moses, that the children of Israel should dwell in booths in the feast of the seventh month, and that they should publish and proclaim in all their cities and in Jerusalem, saying, go forth unto the mount, and fetch olive branches, and pine branches, and myrtle branches, and palm branches, and branches of thick trees, to make booths, as it is written. So the people went forth and brought them, and made themselves booths, every one upon the roof of his house, and in their courts, and in the courts of the house of God, and in the street of the water gate, and in the street of the gate of Ephraim. And all the congregation of them that were come again out of the captivity made booths, and sat under the booths. For since the days of Jeshua, the son of Nun, unto that day, had not the children of Israel done so, and there was very great gladness. Also, day by day, from the first day until the last day, he read in the book of the law of God, and they kept the feast 7 days, and on the eighth day was a solemn assembly according unto the manner. That's a lot of reading, amen. But we love to read the Bible in this church. Praise God. Hallelujah. We love the Word of God. I want you to see, though, that, see, there's a great celebration that's taking place in the way that they chose to celebrate the most beautiful thing that you'd ever want to know. They brought the Word of God out, and they read the Word of God to the people of God. What I want you to see is the celebration all has to do with the fact that the wall had now been completed. The wall was completed. But I need you to also understand that, really my message this morning, I don't even know if I told you, is I want you to know that the joy of the Lord is your strength. Amen?
Amen.
You see, because along the way, there's going to be trial and tribulation. And Nehemiah is not the only one that's sad and downcast regarding the people of God. We already know why Nehemiah was sad and downcast, but this type of problem affects and plagues God's people throughout the annals of the Scripture, throughout the annals of human history. It's going to affect you at some point in time in your walk, I can assure you. It didn't only affect Nehemiah, it affected Elijah, that great prophet I told you about. As a matter of fact, he had this great showdown with the prophets of Baal on Mount Carmel. 450 prophets of Baal that sat at Jezebel's table, the Bible says. To sit at someone's table describes intimacy. You don't just invite anybody over to your house to eat at your table, right? And it describes intimacy, although it probably would be a good thing. Jesus would have done it, amen? It describes intimacy and it describes communion, close fellowship with someone else. She's in fellowship, the queen of the king of the northern kingdom of Israel, King Ahab's wife Jezebel, has 450 prophets of a false god eating at her table. And the land is so sick that Elijah says, hey! And he wants to have a showdown with the prophets of Baal. We know the story. The God that answers by fire showed up and consumed the sacrifice of Elijah. But in the next scene, Elijah is under a juniper tree. Because Jezebel, that one that teaches God's people harlotry, sent a message to Elijah and said, I'm going to do unto you what's been done unto the prophets. Surely you will die. And fear has stricken his heart. And he finds himself on the run, sitting under a juniper tree, saying, oh Lord, won't you take my life? I got to have to tell you this, that anytime the enemy of your soul begins to see God using you in any way, shape, or form, and he begins to smell a threat to his kingdom. Come on, somebody, help me out here. The enemy is not going to release his claws from this kingdom that he is trying to build upon this earth easily. And anytime he begins to smell victory for God in the air, he is going to plan his plan of deception. He is going to try to strike people's hearts with fear. And just as Nehemiah now is weeping because he sees the desolation of Israel because of the people that have gone the way of the enemy, also Elijah now is stricken with fear, and the enemy of his soul has him on the run. But it's not just Elijah, it's also Peter. I'm just giving you some examples. Peter, who loved the Lord with all of his heart, who walked with Jesus, saw the miracles that Jesus performed, was there to hear the words that Jesus spoke. Even whenever in John chapter 6, whenever Jesus said, you must eat my flesh and drink my blood, and so many of the people that were following him left, Jesus turns to them and says, will you leave me too? Peter says, where will we go? You alone have the words of life. Whenever Jesus tells him in Matthew 26, the shepherd will be scattered and you will be offended because of me. The word offended means scandalized. It was the word of scandalizo, where we get scandalized. It means to be appalled or horrified by something either immoral or improper. It's improper, Lord. This can't happen. No, it's going to cause scandalization in you, because when you see what they do to me, you are going to be offended. You are going to be tripped up because of this, and you are going to scatter it all. Peter said, not so, Lord. All men may be offended of you, but I will never be offended of you. And even in the garden, whenever the enemy comes through the presence of Judas and Peter realizes what's taking place, he tries to take matters in his own hands, in his own flesh. He pulls a sword from his scabbard, probably trying to take the old boy's head off, and misses and cuts his ear off, Malchus, the servant of the high priest, and in reality, trying the best way that he knows how to protect the Lord. You can't protect anything, Peter. But yet the same day, later that night, standing by a campfire as he's followed them taking Jesus to the place where they would question him and accuse him, here he stands by a campfire and he denies Jesus the first of three times by a campfire to a teenage girl. And now the next thing you know, the Bible says that he walked away from that fire weeping. There's times in the life of the people of God when they will find themselves in circumstances and they will find great heaviness upon their hearts, and they will find themselves weeping because they don't know how it is that they're going to get out of this situation. You and I need to understand that there's times in the lives of God's people where we're filled with great sorrow, a place or a season in our lives where we feel hopeless, where the physical circumstances seem that there's an insurmountable obstacle that stands in the way of all of our hope or victory. And these times we can find ourselves overwhelmed with grief or sorrow, just as Nehemiah, just as Elijah, just as Peter, and even just as you, Christian. But I wanted to tell you something. My first point that I want to speak to you about this morning is, don't you quit. Don't quit, Elijah. Don't quit on God. He just gave you a big victory. The enemy's not going to quit. You can't quit. Jesus didn't quit. He carried the cross up the hill. Don't quit, Peter. See, the Bible says that Peter turned around and he said later, I'm going fishing. And it wasn't just a regular old fishing trip, but in the Greek language, it's descriptive of, I'm changing my mind from being a fisher of men to going back and being a fisher of fish. This thing didn't work out the way that I planned it. I failed the one who loved me and died for me. I'm no longer worthy to hold on to what it is that he called me to do, and so I'm going back to my former way of life. The enemy of your soul, even though you've made mistakes, even though you've gone the wrong way in the midst of your journey, that's what he wants to make you do. He wants to make you quit ultimately. He wants to get you off the wall. He wants to make you stop being a child of God so that God's glory can live in you. Don't you quit, Christian.
Amen.
In the midst of them rebuilding this wall, I have to tell you, if you go back to Nehemiah chapter 4, there were obstacles and there was frustration along every step of the way. The Bible says in chapter 4, they're building the wall now. Verse 1, it says, it came to pass that when Sanballat heard that we builded the wall, he was wroth. That means he was full of anger. He took great indignation and he mocked the Jews. He spoke before his brethren in the army of Samaria and said, "What do these feeble Jews? Will they fortify themselves? Will they sacrifice? Will they make an end in a day? Will they revive the stones out of the heaps of the rubbish which are burned?" Now Tobiah the Ammonite was by him, and he said, "Even that which they build, if a fox go up, he shall even break down their stone wall." You see what they're doing? He's mocking them. He's chiding them. In modern vernacular, we say he's dogging them. He's got jokes. He's like, "Oh, even if a fox jumps up on this wall, the whole thing's just going to crumble down. What do these feeble little weak Jews think that they're going to do?" And let me tell you something. The enemy will whisper the same thing in your ear. Come on, somebody, help me out now. You know that it's true. When you find yourself in a place of failure, when you find yourself in a place where you feel as though you have failed the Lord, the enemy rushes in and he will begin to whisper in your ear words of failure, trying to convince you that it's all hopeless, that it's all over with. But I'm here to tell you that God's got a plan. He's just looking, just like these stones are broke down and these gates are burned, God's got a plan of restoration, hallelujah, and reconciliation. And he's going to continue to move forward. He has chosen, listen to me, he has chosen to use fallen man where he would place his glory on the inside of them. 2 Corinthians chapter 4 speaks of the fact that within these earthen vessels we have a treasure.
Amen.
Where the glory would be given unto God. God puts his glory and his presence on the inside of these earthen vessels, this fallen clay, so that he in turn can receive the glory. He goes on to say in verse 5, Nehemiah begins to pray. He says, "Cover not their iniquity. Let not their sin be blotted out from before thee, for they have provoked thee to anger before the builders. So built we the wall, and all the wall was joined together unto the half thereof, for the people had a mind to do it." See, even in the midst of obstacles, even in the midst of frustration, the people of God were determined that this wall had to be rebuilt. The wall had to be rebuilt because there had to be protection for the city, because the temple had to be restored so that the presence of God could dwell with his people Israel, so that the altar could be restored, so that sacrifice could be offered once again. Did you hear what he said? The mocker in the beginning, he said, "What do these feeble Jews?" Verse 2, "Will they fortify themselves? Will they sacrifice?" See, sacrifice represents the cross again. It's written throughout the entirety of Scripture. What you and I have to understand is that it's the sacrifice of Jesus and the shedding of his blood that gives us access to his presence, that allows his presence to strengthen us, to fortify us, and no matter what it is that we face. How many times have you struggled? How many times have you had things that you didn't know how to get free from? Amen?
Amen.
And you try to clean yourself up on the outside. You know what I'm talking about?
Yes.
You try to clean yourself up on the outside and it just leaves you broken again because you can't do it. You can't get it done.
That's right. Yeah.
That's because the work of the Lord is an internal work. Yeah. That's because the grace of God works on the inside of a man. Yeah. He changes him on the inside to where it's become reflected on the outside, like the psalm says. The reality of it is that I've learned this, and I know that there's some other people in this room that have been walking with the Lord for a while. They've learned it too. As well as the gospel works in your life, and it works beautifully. There's nothing wrong with the gospel. There's nothing wrong with the power of God. Hallelujah. It works real good. It works just like it's supposed to work. The problem lies right here. The problem lies right here in the heart of man. Because listen, you can know the message of the cross all you want to, and lo and behold, you find out that there's some stuff in you that you didn't even know that was there, and the next thing you know, your flesh wants it, and you don't want to let go. Come on, somebody, and listen to me. Sometimes people that begin to learn the message of the cross, they don't even realize it's happening. They get right. prideful, more and more prideful every day. I know stuff that they don't even know. I know things about the gospel that poor people don't even know. Listen to me. Be careful, Christian, because knowledge puffs up. True knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ not only teaches you how to access grace, but it will also begin to produce in you the spirit of Jesus. Jesus loved people. Jesus wanted to see people set free. Hallelujah. He didn't want to look down on them and beat them up and act as though he knew things that they didn't know, even though it was true. He wanted to teach them the things that he knew so that they might have the light that he had, that they might be able to share it with others.
Amen.
It says in verse chapter 6, we still talking about don't quit. Don't quit. See, they ended up sending letters to him. And what they told him to Nehemiah, this Sanballat and Tobiah, the enemies in this story. They sent letters starting in verse 6 of chapter 6, wherein it was written, "It is reported amongst the heathen, saying that you and the Jews think to rebel, for which cause thou buildest the wall, that you may be their king according to these words." In other words, Nehemiah, you're building this wall so that you can be the king of your people. "And you have also appointed prophets to preach of thee at Jerusalem, saying, there is a king in Judah, and now it shall be reported to the king," talking about the king of Persia, "according to these words, come now, therefore, let us take counsel together." Come on, Nehemiah, you can't do this. We know what you're up to. You're building a wall so that you can be the king in Judah, and you're going to try to rebel against the king of Persia. And so then Nehemiah sends a letter back to them, and he says, "There are no such things done as you say, but you feignest them out of your own heart." In other words, you're devising these things. You're making these things up. "For they all made us afraid, saying, their hands shall be weakened from the work, that it be not done. Now therefore, O God, strengthen my hands." Mm-hmm. See, the enemy of your soul, like I told you before, he wants to begin to whisper lies to your ears. And ultimately what he wants to do is he wants to weaken your hands. The hands represent the work of the Lord. He wants to get you to quit. He wants to get you to quit the work of God so that, and the work of God in you. And it's not just taking care of nursery, although we can use some nursery help. It's not just being a teacher in children's church. We can always use more teachers if you're ready to do it. It's not just singing in the musical group. I think I'm going to start keeping my hands out of that because I don't know that we need to add a whole lot more people, and we'll let the music people handle that, all right? But listen to me. It's not just being in the music group. The reality of it is that it's allowing the work of God to take place on the inside of your heart, amen, so that the work of God can be produced through you in other people's lives. Have we gotten that point across in this church? I hope that we have, because much of what's going on in the church today is all about these groups that we have internally in the midst of the church, and we call that ministry, right? And what they say is that we make a conducive environment for people to come in from the outside, and that's how we're going to minister to them. But the reality of it is that I see Jesus ministering to his disciples the word of God changing them, and them going out into the world where God has placed them, wherever you work, whether it be oceaneering, whether it be at the realty place, whether it be a nurse practitioner in a home or on the rig. God brings you to the place where you are, and you live life as a light in the midst of darkness.
Amen.
Amen. The enemy wants to weaken your hand. He wants to whisper lies in your ears. He wants to tell you that the obstacle is too big, that the task is insurmountable, and that you can't get it done. But yet Nehemiah cries out, "Oh, strengthen my hands, O Lord." Sometimes you might find yourself in the midst of circumstances and you don't even know how you're going to get there. You find yourself sorrowful. You find yourself weeping. Listen to me. The joy of the Lord is your strength. Just cry out, "Lord, strengthen my hands."
Yes.
A while back, I was feeling kind of down. I mean, it's not important what it was all about. I was feeling kind of down. I could feel the enemy was whispering that stuff in my ear. You don't need to be doing this. You just need to give up, man. You need to give up and quit. And I could feel the Lord put a word in my spirit. And I just said it out loud. I had never heard nobody say this before, but I said it out loud. I said, "Lord, weld my hands to the plow." You understand what I'm trying to say? The enemy would try to do everything that he can to shut the mouth of you and to shut the mouth of me. He'll try to bring suffering, frustration in the midst of your life, obstacles in the midst of your life, and Lord, strengthen my hands and weld my hands to the plow that they might not be removed, that in the end I might hear those words, well done, my good and faithful servant. I don't know what you want to hear when you look in the eyes of your Savior, but I want to hear, well done, my good and faithful servant. I want to stay true to the Lord. Lord, give us grace. Give us strength that we might stay true to you. There's going to be valleys along the way. There's going to be mountaintops and valleys. There's going to be failures. There's going to be successes. But listen to me. Don't let the enemy make you quit.
Amen.
Don't let the enemy make you quit. Hold on, Christian. Amen. He says it again in verse 15 of that same chapter, chapter 6. So the wall was finished in the 25th day of the month of Elul. Thank God they didn't quit. And so that's where we are in chapter 8. The wall was finished. A big celebration. And you go, hey, Ezra, scribe, priest, go get the book of the law. Stand up on this pulpit and read unto us the word of God. And what they found out on this day was this. That this was a special day. It was the first day of the seventh. Now, to those of us who don't understand why that was so special, let me just take a little bit of time and explain to you. According to Leviticus 23, this was the Feast of Trumpets. This was the new year.
Amen.
See, that's my second point. First point is, don't quit. Second point is, it's a new day. It's a new day, meaning it's a new beginning. Israel's history up to this point has been one of frustration, one of failure, one of going in the wrong direction, causing captivity, causing destruction. The wall is tumbled down. The gates are burned. But now God has strengthened them. The walls have been rebuilt. And it's the first day of the seventh month. Blow the trumpet in Zion. Hallelujah. The shofar, the ram's horn, blown. Hallelujah on the Feast of Trumpets. Signaling another day. What day is that? Well, in 9 more days, they blow the trumpet to prepare you for what's coming in 9 more days. Get yourself ready! Because in 9 more days, on the 10th day of this month, is the Day of Atonement. Oh, hallelujah. Israel now hasn't had a Day of Atonement because they hadn't had a temple, because they hadn't had a wall, and they hadn't had an altar of sacrifice. But now the Day of Atonement is coming back. The day when all the nation's sins will be forgiven for the rest of this year. And on that day, it's all about a lamb and 2 goats. A lamb that's slain and his blood collected and brought on the inside of that veil and sprinkled again, like I told you earlier, on the mercy seat, allowing the presence of God to dwell with his people, and 2 goats. One goat dying for the sins of the people. The other goat, the sin of the people, transferred to it and released in the wilderness to take that sin where it not be seen anymore. All of these types of Jesus. I can tell you, Jesus wasn't no goat. A goat represents the rebel, the obstinate one. The goat is Matt. Jesus took Matt's goatedness, if I can create a word for you. He took Matt's goatedness upon him, and he, on the cross, died for Matt's sin, and he drove Matt's sin into a wilderness, away from the presence of God, where the God of glory, who is infinite and can remember everything that any human could even imagine to remember, chooses not to remember the sins that were placed upon Jesus and brought him to the wilderness. You might try to remember it because the enemy wants to whisper in your ear, but I'm here to tell you, the goat took your sin into the wilderness. It's gone, amen. And as far as the east is from the west, the presence of God now can be restored into you because amen. Sin, hallelujah, has been removed. Praise God. That's the Day of Atonement. That's the day of liberation. That's the day of the shedding of blood and the removal of sin. We thank you. What a beautiful day it was.
Yes.
When they began to read in the law and they realized this is the day. As we read in the book, surely they got to the book of Leviticus and they realized this is the day right here. Ezra the scribe, he went and got the book and they're reading in the law. This is the day. It's on this specific day. This is the Feast of Trumpets. The Day of Atonement was right around the corner. Then the Bible says in verse 13 that they came back the second day. That was point two. Point one was long. Don't quit. Point two was, hallelujah, it's a new day. It's a new day, a new year. It's a new beginning. Amen?
Amen.
Just remember that. God gives you new beginnings.
Yes.
Praise God. The Word of God says, Actually, there was one part that I didn't want to miss. It talks about right here that as they began to hear the word of God, the scripture says in verse 10, go your way, eat the fat and drink. It says in verse 9, I'm sorry. And Nehemiah, which is the Tirshatha, and Ezra the priest, the scribe, and the Levites that taught the people, said unto all the people, this day is holy unto the Lord your God. Mourn not, nor weep, for all the people wept when they heard the words of the law. Then he said, "Go," he said unto them, go your way, eat the fat, drink the sweet, and send portions unto them for whom nothing is prepared. For this day is holy unto our Lord. Neither be ye sorry, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. The word of God is being read. The word of God is being expounded upon. The people are hearing the word of God. They realize where they've been and they begin to weep. Now, you're not going to get me to be a lying preacher to you. I'm going to tell you right now, you better be careful of that pretty Oriental guy that's on TBN. Because I'm going to tell you, he wrote in a book where he said, you do not have to repent because you're the righteousness of God. Let me tell you something, that's a half-truth and a little bit of leaven leavens the whole lump. The reality of it is that no, the true child of God, when he fails God, he will feel the sorrowfulness in his heart that he has failed God, and there will be sorrow and there will be weeping. Solomon said in chapter 3, there's a day and a season for everything under heaven, and there's a time for weeping, there's a time for sorrow, but there's also a time for singing, and there's also a time for dancing. Amen. And let me tell you something, if you want to be restored into the presence of God, you have to come to a place where you are sorrowful for your failure towards God. True repentance means that you have a mind change.
Amen.
Amen. It means that your mind now lines up with the mind of God, and you realize that you were wrong and that He was right the whole time.
Amen.
Amen.
Lord, I was wrong.
Yes.
You were right. Oh Lord, do a work in me. Oh Lord, forgive me. Change me. But then, whenever repentance takes place, the Lord wants you and I to know you don't have to walk under a cloud of guilt. You don't have to walk under the bondage of sin. The goat took your sin. It's been cast into the wilderness. It's away from the presence of God. This is a holy day. And it represents the fact that you've been forgiven, that God has a plan. Don't mourn. Don't weep. Today is a day of joy. And the joy of the Lord is your strength. Amen. Amen. God wants to return His joy into your heart as you continue to believe in His plan. He wants to fill you up with His presence. He wants to strengthen you. Point one, don't quit. Point two, it's a new day. Point three starts in verse 13. It says, on the second day, we're gathered together the chief of the fathers of all the people, the priests and the Levites and Ezra the scribe, even understand the words of the law. So they came back the next day and they started all over again. Let's read the word. And this is what they found written in the law, which the Lord... All this is found in Leviticus 23, by the way. The Feast of Trumpets, the Day of Atonement, and also this next feast we're going to read about. Verse 14, the Lord had commanded by Moses that the children of Israel should dwell in booths in the feast of the seventh month. On the first day of Tishri, that's the seventh month, they would blow the trumpet. On the 10th day, they would have the Day of Atonement. On the 15th day, they would go, the Bible says they'd go get olive branches, they'd go get myrtle branches, they'd go get branches from the nearby woods, and they would make for themselves booths on the outside of their dwelling or on the roof of their housetop. And there they would live for 7 days. In the scripture, it says they hadn't done it since the time of Joshua, the son of Nun. That means even during the time frame of King David, they weren't doing this. But when they read it here, that's what they did. They went, they built themselves booths, and they still do it today in Israel. For 7 days, they live in a tent. They go camping, if you will, but right there by their home, because they're willingly, what they're doing is they're recognizing that God was their provider. I need you to know that, number three, God's provider. See, when you find yourself in the midst of this turmoil and you find yourself in the midst of this place of sorrowfulness, you need to be reminded that no matter what it is that you need, God is your provider. They remember how they journeyed in the wilderness for 40 years, how God had delivered them out of Egypt, but that His presence was with His people, that a cloud by day guided them, a fire by night guided them, that even though they were hungry, He provided them manna in the midst of the wilderness. Yes, there were rough times. There was bitter water and there was poison from snakes, but God brought healing. And listen to me, both of those are types of the cross. And for the bitter water, he said, throw some wood in there. You might find yourself drinking bitter water sometimes, but the wood is representative of the cross. And the cross, listen to me, oh, he preaches too much on the cross. No! You need to understand the cross is all about access. Access to the presence of God. And when the presence of God is restored in your life, there's nothing, hallelujah, that he cannot do for you. There's nothing that he cannot fix for you. Amen. And he will begin to go to work for you.
Amen.
Your waters may be bitter, but you need to put the cross in there.
Amen.
The snakes might be poisonous, but put that snake on a pole. Put the snake on the pole and lift it up. Jesus said, just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up. Jesus hid the snake, but he took your snakedness, he took my snakedness, and he put it upon himself. And just as the pole was lifted up, Jesus was suspended between heaven and earth, and there as the sin bearer of the sins of humanity, he bore your sin, he bore my sin, and as doing so, he now has restored us into the presence of God.
Amen. Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
They lived in those tents for 7 days, and it reminded them that they were also pilgrims on the journey. I need you to remember that, Christian. Yeah, I say it all the time, but I'm going to keep on pounding you with this. You're a pilgrim on a journey.
That's right.
Amen.
This place is not your
home. Amen.
This place is hostile towards you.
That's right.
Amen. Jesus said if they hate you, you need to remember something. They first hated me.
That's right.
You talk enough about Jesus in public places, and you're going to start seeing. They're going to crinkle their nose at you.
Yep.
You start talking about Jesus enough in some churches, and you're going to start noticing that Christians will crinkle their nose at you. Because when the darling of heaven becomes resident on the inside of your heart, you begin to speak forth the preciousness and the beauty of Jesus. Some people just ain't ready to hear it. I can't help you, dude. I can't help you, ma'am. That's who I talk about. I talk about Jesus. And I understand. I'm starting to be able to catch on. I'm starting to be able to see the far away distant look in your eyes as they roll off to the corner over there. And I'm realizing that at this point in time, it's kind of like throwing a pearl before swine.
Right.
I'm not going to tell them that. I'm learning to be better and more to season my speech with salt.
Yeah.